So I'm going to talk a little bit about hybrid versus native app development from the point of view from Notes. So, but before we jump into that, I will just give you a little brief on myself. So I'm Casper, I'm CTO and partner in Notes. I've done mobile applications since 2009, started with Symbian apps and moved into Android. Then the last 5 years I've spent a lot of time in backend development as well. This is the language frameworks I do, like PHP, Swift, Java, Android development. And when I'm not doing client projects or working in Notes, then I'm fairly active in open source projects. So this is my GitHub stats. All of you know GitHub, right? So social development platform for contribution to open source projects. So in Notes, we've done a lot of applications the last many years. I checked the Hockey app, which is the name of App Center before the Microsoft bought them. At the moment, as Sune described, the App Center is what it's going to be in very soon. They still have like quite some features they need to move to App Center before it's full. But I checked that last week, and we have 434 apps done over since 2009. Of course, this is also white label and iOS and Android, Windows, etc. But more than 300 different app projects have been done. And we've done native iOS, Android, Windows, Unity, Titanium, Xamarin Forms, native, Ionic, React Native. So we kind of tried a lot of them. But like I think 85% or something is native. But before we move on to that, let's just like the whole hybrid versus native thing. I'm just gonna go through my how I'm gonna use the words in this presentation. So we all know hybrid. It's about combining a couple of things and works. We've seen some examples where it's been working really well, and some examples where it's not probably something you would buy a car which can sail. And native, yeah, so that's the original like kind of description. So in my talk here, native is going to be what Apple and Google is providing, their own frameworks. And hybrid is everything else which are trying to accommodate the same app development. So there, I know there's both like HTML5 hybrid, there's cross-compiled, etc., but they're all called hybrid in this talk. And I know, for example, Xamarin, they call it native because they compile into native, but it's still not Google and Apple's framework directly you're using. And then they call that pure native. So they just invented that word themselves. But yeah, a couple of years back, there was four big platforms, and that was when we still had BlackBerry and Windows on the game. And of course, building four code bases in native development to get all four of them, that could be very time consuming. Today, there's really only two players left, which is iOS and Android. Microsoft gave up now and are starting to do the new phones on Android. The same with BlackBerry. And I don't think we're going to see any other new players there. I think Amazon tried and et cetera, but like, I think this is what we're going to see now. And hybrid options, there's a lot of them at the moment. Some of them are like these JavaScript virtual machines running in view rendering. Some of them will compile into computer code, ARM native. Some of them will run like virtual machines and like React Native. So for this talk, we're gonna focus on the three big ones, Ionic, Xamarin, and React. So I'm just gonna jump into it. So Ionic, that's a hybrid platform, open source introduced in 2013. We started looking at that because we had a front-end team doing Angular development, and like the whole code base from Angular to Ionic is everything can be reused besides the routing and the views. So that sounded really cool. So let's look more into that. It's open source. So how it works is what Sunit recently described, that you have this web view where you put all your standard web development in, HTML, JavaScript, CSS, etc. And you have all the Cadova plugins, which is like a JavaScript communication to native components. And then you have, of course, it's running on your native, on mobile apps. So if we look at some of the cases done by Ionic, there's quite a lot of cases, and if you look into the site, but they're not a lot of the really big names. I didn't know any of these really. But if you look into GitHub, it's fairly popular, 35K stars in GitHub. That's a good amount. That means this is an active open source project. You can also see the traffic. They raised a lot of funding. Everything seems healthy. So let's look into it. So what did we expect? We expect that we could utilize a front-end team which knew Angular. There would be high code reuse, web to app, but also iOS to Android. We knew it was a new player, not owned by any of the big companies. Maybe there would be some of the big companies looking at acquiring at some point, but at this point, still not. We didn't see this for like really big applications. We started out in the small, tested out a couple of apps. So what we figured out after 6 applications, 5,000 hours development time, was everything regarding easy to get going with Angular background, that was true. We did some really rapid things really fast. The reuse numbers we were introduced to before we started was more or less correct. There was a good amount of reuse between the platforms. But what we also, a lot of the cons we figured out was, so a lot of missing APIs, limit customization. You had to do it exactly how they wanted to do. If you wanted to change a little bit or move this icon or change the color of this component, you had to like really dig into it. Cadova is really unreliable, so it's a package of a lot of of a lot of libraries, and it's open source, and no one really have the responsibility to finish things off. So you can come in and you can find, for example, we had an example where we needed to upload an image that worked fine with the plugin. Then we need to change it to upload an image and a thumbnail. Then you couldn't use the plugin for that. And you had to build that in yourself, sending 2 files. And of course, that's not something you expect to spend time on. The build process is slow to make the IPA and the APKs, which is the standard for iOS and Android file format. And then the last things is like really performance issues, massive performance issues. As soon as you start doing anything fancy, it just dropped. If you had the newest iPhone, it might work really well, but if you had like a medium Android phone, it would drop massively in performance. Stuff like interacting with native components or native features, like opening the camera, that could take a couple seconds on iOS. That could be acceptable, but it could take 20 seconds on a bad Android phone. And that's of course completely unacceptable. Another thing we figured out was there's like 3 to 5 seconds boot time on the application just to set everything up before your code starts getting executed. For example, that's not too bad if it's just launching the app the first time. We all have these splash screens on the big apps anyways. But for example, if you get a push notification, you need to open into something, then you also have the 5 seconds. So we figured out we ended up spending more time because we tried to get it up in quality, but it was impossible to get the last 10% niceness quality we have seen from our native apps. So we ended up spending more time building voice apps. Here's like a graph of the comparisons where you can see like really kicks off in the beginning. One guy is suddenly doing 2 guys' work almost. But then in the end, you just keep spending time on getting things optimized to figure out this Android phone is not working and like this is taking too long. Can we do something about that? So we ended up like after these 6 projects, we evaluated and said like we're not going to advise any clients in doing this, even for small projects. It's not worth it. And that's where we are today. I would say if you have a big Angular website, you want to try something out, go ahead, try it out. But expect if you need this in production at some point that you probably need to redo it. Cool. Next one, Xamarin. Soon already introduced a little bit to it. So I'm just going to give a brief introduction. So this is a company which saw the hybrid thing really early on and was really clever about it. So they decided to say, okay, we have iOS and Android going each of their direction. So we port the entire SDK, as it's called, or all the APIs you have to communicate with iOS and Android folks into C#, which is a really strong language. And the lucky thing for them was, as soon as Microsoft started having tough times getting their own platform up running, they acquired this company. So this was a good business for these guys. Some of the things if you go to any of these Xamarin workshops or conferences or like seminars, they will show you something like this. Best of both worlds, you have all the native access, but you still have the option to write things once. You can get up to 95% code reuse. I heard that from a seminar in London last year. That sounds really good. Of course, they have two options, as Sune mentioned: forms and native forms, where we have the shared views between them. So that's obviously here where you're going to get the most code reuse, but also the most limitation. Some of the cases they have on the site. There's some big companies here doing this. What you have to know as well is like the Slack app is not built in Xamarin, that's Electron. So it's probably some app they're using internally or something they have for that. So it's not necessarily the big app they have in Xamarin, but these companies are using it. And the case I saw was called British Airways. They had an internal application for reading news about the company as employees. And that was the one they got 95% code reuse on. So open source recently. So you can see compared to Ionic, the star numbers are really, really small. So this is, Microsoft have open sourced this, but it's not really embraced by the community at any point. It is maintained by Microsoft at this point. That's what we have to agree on. They have something called Xamarin University, and you get certified. So the whole development chain Microsoft is pushing with the certificates, bronze, silver, gold, all these things. It's in here as well. So you can send your developers to your university, and then they can be educated in doing this. So we saw access to all native APIs. C# is cool. Visual Studio is great. No licenses. There used to be a license on before Microsoft bought it, that got removed. Sounds really good with the code reuse, Microsoft behind it. What's not to like? A lot of good things about it. So we started out doing it already back in Xamarin 3, I think, and then we've been following it along the last 5 years, it must be. So we've done 5 apps now and spent around 4,000 hours in Xamarin. The first thing we figured out was that Xamarin Forms is unusable if you have any kind of design team which wants to have something to say, because there's way too many limitations in what you need to do. And what Sune said, I think if you can work that that way, where you can say, okay, we designed this way, but then we figure out there's a limitation in forms, can we change the design, then you could probably get pretty far. But if you have a design team doing some design, getting it user tested, all that, and then you come back and tell them that this cannot be done. That's not the situation we're working with in Notes, at least, and we need to figure out how to get it looking like that. So Forms was out of the table, then it was Xamarin Native, and the code reuse we had there on our applications was between 20 and 40%. I talked to a couple of Xamarin development houses around Europe, and they say that's the percentage. If you do 40%, then you did good. So that's the percentage you should aim for. So of course, that's a big jump from 95%. Another good thing with Xamarin is they're very helpful. They have support desks. You can set up Skype meetings, all these kinds. They really want to get you going with it. So that's good. So a lot of the cons was so Xamarin is another moving platform between your development and iOS and Android. So there's a learning curve in that as well. There will be some APIs which are Xamarin only APIs you need to understand, and that's of course what gives you code reuse. So the moving platform, it has its own box. I checked last week, 5,300 open box on Xamarin itself. And then you have iOS and Android, which also have problems, a box. The missing libraries Rune was mentioning as well. And because of this middle layer, you sometimes get a crash where it crashes inside Xamarin. And it's really hard to figure out what actually happened and what can you change about it besides setting up a ticket in the support desk. community is a lot smaller than iOS and Android. So again, the open source packages, all these things are not really existing. The whole thing started with no licenses, but then we figured out with, like, if you need to use profiling, you need to get Visual Studio Enterprise, which is of course paid. And then we had a couple of things during the years where we ended up spending more time on maintenance on these projects, because one example here is iOS 10. They introduced this swipe from the left, where you could go back in the stack. Didn't work on Xamarin. We had to upgrade a major version on all our Xamarin apps to get that working. It worked out of the box on iOS and Android. The 32 to 64 bit, that was also just an update in Xcode if you had the right target levels already. It was a major update in Xamarin, so we actually spent 2 weeks on one of our apps just getting that. We didn't really have an initial cost saving. Like, this is, like you can see, so it kind of following native development for us, ended up spending a little longer time in the end on getting things polished. I think if you spend even more time investing, so this is compared to like native developers who have done native apps as well, you could probably get it lower, but like the idea was that it should be half price. That was what we went in to at least 20% cheaper or 25% cheaper. And we didn't see that initial cost saving. So like, and here's the slide on the enterprise, Visual Studio Enterprise. So we figured out this is needed for us to do applications. So it's $3,000 a year per developer, worth taking into account as well. So for us, we have 15 iOS and Android developers as well. So we're heavily involved in iOS in native development. We couldn't really see the benefits in this. It didn't give us the cost saving we hoped for. So why have it? That was kind of what we figured out. We still do a couple of projects now and then in it, and I could see some benefits if you could get forms up running, get the code use up. It might be good if you already have a big C# team doing backends, etc. Of course, worth looking into. But if you'd look at it completely standalone and you want to do a best-in-class application for iOS, Android, we would not recommend you going Xamarin. The last one I have in the presentation today is React Native. That's one of the newer ones. It's introduced in 2013, and it's Facebook which is behind it. Open source, they recently put it into an MIT license. So in here you can do iOS, Android, and Windows as well, but Windows is pretty much out. So what is the benefits here is that you'll be able to use the power of, let's just jump into how it works first. So the way it works is like you have your JavaScript runtime environment, which is getting compiled down to the applications on iOS. It's part of the OS. On Android, it will come with the application. You have your native code, so you can both do JavaScript or native code and put that in the same apps, which is pretty cool. But every time you need to communicate between JavaScript and native code, you have to go through the bridge, as they call it. So if you look into some of the cases, of course, a lot of the Facebook's own product, Facebook, Instagram, and in the application today in Facebook, they have some of the setting screens, and the whole marketplace is done in React Native. The same when you look at Instagram, some of the sub pages are done 100% in React Native today. And then, of course, Airbnb. We'll get more into that later. Really big on the open source part. This is one of the most started GitHub repos in the world, and you can see the traffic and contributions is really high. So a lot of things is happening here. We thought this was our initial thought. Like, awesome, we can have some code reuse, but we can also jump out and just do native development if we need to. We can use all the power of the newest web technologies like ECMAScript. We knew it's going to be a harder learning curve than Angular Ionic because it's not really copy paste of that. maybe if you had like React.js developers at that point, that would be more reuse for your team, but we didn't. Facebook is behind it, which is of course a big company with a lot of developers, but it's also a company known for cutting the losses when they don't believe in a tech stack anymore. So they started up a lot of open source initiatives the last many years, and some of them they closed. For example, Pass or some of their animation libraries where they really pushed them in the beginning and suddenly they just did. What we figured out was we got really high code sharing between our platforms, fast to develop. So all that was good. We could reuse a lot of the JavaScript libraries we knew from web development already. Some of the cons is that there was no storyboard UI designing. Debugging is hard because, again, you have this moving platform in the middle, so you need to debug through layers. It's still in beta, so there's a lot of breaking changes. I think it's 0.5.7 now beta. So every minor update, they're allowed to break the API, so that's annoying. You still have the longer boot times where you need to boot up the entire React Native core before you could start having your own code running, especially on notification, that's annoying. Android support is bad, really bad. As soon as you get your apps in production, you will get a lot of these cases where it just doesn't work on this specific Android phone, on this Android phone. And it is because the whole JavaScript environment has to be compiled out to the applications. It's an open source project you use for that. And iOS, it's part of the OS. So that's one of the big problems I have. So we also saw, like, slowly we started moving more code to native than we originally ended up expecting. Maintenance cost was high because of the breaking changes all the time. And slower support for new features. Last year with iPhone X, the new screens coming out, took 2 months before it was supported in React Native from the day the phone was released. And then you had to upgrade your code base and get it through a review. So it could be 3 or 4 months before you had support for it. We only done 3 applications in React Native so far, spent around 1,500 hours. So it's still one of the newer hybrid frameworks we're using. And I think it's very interesting to look at in the future for us, but as long as it's in beta, it's not that many projects we feel we can push the clients out to, like a beta platform. So a bit the same story as Xamarin, but with more time spent in the end on getting the segmentation right on Android. So sometimes you can do things really fast, sometimes that's a roadblock and you need to do it twice anyway, and you spend a lot of time trying to get to that point, and then the end, a lot of time on polishing. So I think our recommendation right now is that it makes sense for small, medium applications if you don't have a senior team, a senior native team. The same if you have a web platform in React.js, might be worth looking into it. It could also be for if you have a big application, you pick a couple of the views, and for example, like the keychain, the settings, et cetera, and do them in React Native, that could be something you could look into. But for us right now, we don't, as long as it's in beta and this unstable, we don't think it's worth it if you have the competence in doing native apps. And in the same time, for example, the last scenario where you put some of your application into React, we don't think it's worth bring in another technology just for so simple things which can be done fast natively as well. And also React Native have a fairly tough summer, so Airbnb, the biggest backer, decided to publicly go away from them. Then there was silence from Facebook for a month or something afterwards, and then they came out with a State of the Union about React Native, and they kind of admit that there's some massive issues in the whole architecture of React Native, the whole bridge, which is an async solution today, that needs to be looked into again. So I expect that we're going to see some major updates to this as well. But maybe it will get better in half a year, a year. But for those who already invested in React Native, that will probably be a big refactor coming around the corner. So conclusion for us is like, up in the two top graphs, that's iOS and Android natively, and the hybrid platforms are the one and button. There's still a massive difference in the community sizes of these things. There's a lot of hype about hybrid apps, build once, deploy twice, all these things. But if we look over like on the communities and how many apps are getting built, native is definitely the biggest. Also, if you look at salaries for developers, this is I asked a couple of our recruiters in London. How hard is it to find the different developers and what is their cost? And they all said it's really hard to find mobile developers, so that's why it's one or two on all of them. But you can also see some price differences between the native developers and the hybrid developers, worth taking into account as well. So for Notes and our point of view, we keep following along with hybrid. We think it's very interesting, and the day it's ready for that, we will be the first ones on it. But still, we believe the safe choice, if you want to build a really ambitious application, is to go with native. If you have a smaller team, already an Angular site, you want to try something out, look at Ionic. If you already have a C# team, consider Xamarin. If it's really important for you to get the same code base, but I would not expect you to save any money on that choice. And I think for startups where they can live with the movement of React and React Native, that's a very interesting platform as well. Conclusion from us is like native apps is the safe choice at this point. So why are we asked ourselves the questions? So why are people looking at hybrid apps? I think it's some reducing cost, some synergy in the stack is utilized, some teams. There's a new one coming out here, hybrid, called Flutter. Google is behind that. It looks very interesting. A little bit like React Native, you get the performance for that. But I think they did a big error in picking a development language called Dart. Probably none of you have any developers doing Dart at this point. So let's see about how that's going to end up. Another direction you can go look at is like utilizing your teams across front end and back end. So for example, server side Swift is starting to happen now. You can do Swift on the server. Or now with Kotlin, you can start doing Kotlin on the servers. So then you can get some utilization between your front end and back end teams, worth looking into as well. Yes, so that's it for me. Any questions to